and occupy only 1/4 or 1/10 of Kolkata and are very comfortable within that closed circle environment, which is our comfort zone. To move out of that comfort zone and experience another, that another can be another community, another faith, another belief system, it can be anybody, or another geography. Bengalis live in North Calcutta, Marwadis live in North Calcutta, but we don't like to go to North Calcutta. Why? Because there is a perception issue. I've had my friends telling me, you're doing your thesis in North Calcutta, who goes to North Calcutta? Yeah. So these are the realities. So how does, coming to your next question, how does design probably break these barriers? Is really then, it becomes design's responsibility to blur the boundaries. I obviously don't have an answer to this is the solution A and the solution B, but so much of it is also mindset. We don't think twice about going to North Calcutta during a Durga Pujo. Baag Bazaar Pujo dekhte jabo, College Square dekhte jabo, but rest of the time we don't go. Yeah. So it's not like we don't want to engage with them, but we want to kind of selectively engage with them. So those are the things that we have to address.
Ma'am, I have a small suggestion in this regard.
Yeah.
So when we are talking about design as a procedure to merge these gaps or merge the communities, don't you feel that an active connection through this can be how we are communicating the design to the society? Like, suppose there's a big thing going on for one of the projects and on this Chinatown, and this has to reach the community actively. So, is there any connection of how we are projecting it to the common people that makes it acceptable to them? Like, if you are portraying it in a very hard and like in the normal way that architects talk in that language, I don't think that people will be very acceptable to it. But if we can scale that down to the normal language, to the normal colloquial language, do you think that this will be effective in little bit merging the gap or
absolutely. See, for example, this is again one of the discussions that we're having with Rukmini and Ovin, that if we look at the state of architecture today in Calcutta, what is the overall understanding, awareness? I'm just taking like a very, very different example. Most of our conversations are actually in closed door. Even like look at the profile of people sitting in this room where we are making a presentation. Yeah, we are all talking to each other and we know we are sensitive. It's almost like reaching to the converted. Forums like this, discussions like this need to happen in a public place which is accessible to somebody who knows nothing about it. So that when they go back from there, there's even if there's a 5% change or shift in that person's thinking, it's going to be a drop in the ocean to bring that change. We can't only do it by talks, seminars, exhibitions, lectures, which are for our own fraternity. We'll never be able to break that.
So, coming back to the Murshidabad project.
Yeah, thank you. That's what I was looking after about that.
So, it's an absolutely wonderful transition between our initiative to the 2015-2016. And I'm just wondering to see what happened next. Is that the rest of the other peoples also willing to change their buildings and what they get benefited out of that? Or they are waiting like a Calcutta Heritage Grade 1 building. All the owners is waiting when they will actually breaks and they will sell it off and builder will take.
So here I think there is like, I'll answer that question by saying that because, and I'm sorry to say this, but because it's a non-Bengali community, I think they're a lot more enterprising and they understand the potential and they have some sort of foresight and vision, and this is like a controversial thing to say. Waiting for demolition by neglect and dhoshe porbe kobe and we don't know. But these people, because these one or two things have happened, no? Now they're thinking, their mind is working, that one has been restored. And there are so many, and so it's really because of the precinct being so tight knit, it provides a huge opportunity, which now they are beginning to see. Yes, it's a huge process of getting that done, convincing the owners and all, but I think the process has been started. But where the roadblock is largely is from the larger connectivity, larger issues of infrastructure, transportation, connectivity to Azimgarh. So even if you have a perfectly restored settlement with all the havelis restored and the temples restored, livelihoods in place, it's still an island in terms of the larger, when the moment you zoom out into the larger context of Bengal. So till that becomes a priority in terms of better connectivity, better infrastructure to really weave into the larger ecosystem of the West Bengal tourism circuit, this will still remain a private initiative.
So are you planning to do something from the government side that it should expand the tourism?
So that's what I think, having MHBS as the anchor organization, and it's therefore not an individual effort. It's rooted through an NGO, through a group of people who are from the place and who are driving it. I think, again, it's a slow process, but the kind of road that has been charted in the last 2 years, I would think there's promise.
Actually, Sandeep Varaka has done this with a big bang. He held a huge event in the indoor stadium. That's when we started with this. So every year he's trying to do something at the end of the year, and he's kind of, you know, asking for a lot of contributions for various people to join hands. And they're organizing these events in Murshidabad to draw the people in.
This is fantastic, because I've seen, I have few examples live, which people bought in heritage buildings and just trying to change, influence government to change the status of the heritage from such a way that he can break these buildings and make these buildings and more commercial activities. Because if the owner has a lucrative opportunities to make the usage of this building, either tax-free or government intervention or something, then he will keep this building as it is.
Absolutely.
And probably he will be more utilized in this same building in completely different ways.
Absolutely.
Rather than selling or trying to wait when it breaks down.
Right.
So I think that initiatives need to be, because
this is the conversation we started with Paul sometime back, how we, till the time we look at conservation as an isolated piecemeal sort of restoration of individual buildings which are beautiful, because everybody's sense of beauty is subjective and it changes, right? So then nothing of what is heritage. But till conservation comes out of this piecemeal beautification and cherry picking approach and really dovetails itself into the planning process where it's backed up by legislation, by incentivization, otherwise why will I, if there is no benefit for me through, and there are multiple tools to do this, get embedded and severe penalty. Like there are other countries which actually have severe penalties if you...
I think one question that I have is sort of, I'm trying to locate your unique sense of research and conservation as a, obviously make this into a mainstream practice, and this is the kind of a practice that you're sort of locating. And there is a follow-up to that, which is the policy design part, you know, which is the space between research and practice, which is space between research and policy and sort of investment strategies, which sort of where finance and design sort of starts sort of collating with each other. I thought that, you know, because we are from Kolkata and we have very similar 2 out of 3 commonalities in terms of academics, that's Lamar Pierre and Sept. I think basically what is happening is that you've identified from, because you're looking at from a distance, that there are these Ghazoliyas of Azinga and Jandara, Chinatown people, and if you dig deeper, there will be multiple such communities. And now, it seemed to me that the teeth lies into now forking economic opportunities from this with a financial angle, which means we need to sort of work with our sort of CA friends in sort of raising bonds or policy level things, which is then backed up by other design ideas, because that's where a lot of our sort of part research, part practice entities live in. I think one sort of suggestion I might have, Kamalika, is that the projects that we've already gone in depth kind of has that fifth chapter used to have in planning reports called implementation and ways forward. That would probably then enable, or maybe that was really the first chapter in certain cases where it will start from, to bring out a more stronger effort. And that could be at a micro level, which is an individual effort. It could be policy level, which is more difficult, but at least we need to know. And then it's also then there are what as designers we feel the design can actually do something.
Right.
And that would probably then make these possibilities go to the next level. And I think Mushidawa is a very a potent case with this. Waiting to
waiting to burst. All the right things to kind of come.
It seems to me that the lack of industrialization in the city, in the state, the promotion of tourism as a viable alternative, and what do you catch on to? I can see Murshidabad and Sundarban are the two, or Bankura, you know, that we're talking about. There are other.
I'm just going to ask the my next question.
Yeah, these three, four anchors we can, you know, take that.
And that's also, I think, to me, where the larger fraternity comes into play.
Sure,
because, you know, when we say about creating an ecosystem of different players who build, bring different skill sets and different strengths that they have, it's really as a collaborative collective that we have to drive this together. It's not a one person, you know, we've again all been taught that architects and Fountainhead, and we're just one person crusaders. We're not one person crusaders. We might see certain processes with a certain intent and a belief, but we have to kind of come together and synergize our strengths to make something happen.
Yeah, I think
at this case,
because I see government typically in Calcutta as the biggest builder today.
As who?
Biggest builder,
government. Yeah.
And they have a power to inclusive all those policies and other things if the right directions are right, through right channels can be posted to them. And just beside the point, what actually I am saying, that Bishnupur is one of the key, very elemental, provocative areas where it could be an extraordinary destination for Bengal. And I'll tell you, it's beyond architecture. With few years of my understanding of rather than crafts of what Bengal can produce, and it can be treated completely. There is a very lack of tweaking in an international market. Just give an example of Sri Lanka, how they have done in barefoot. Sri Lankan arts and crafts has been treated one of the finest way to packaged internationally and sell it to across the world. Same thing, Bengal has immense opportunity of terracotta, what you see, and Murshidabad silk and woodwork, crafts, Pottochitro, lot of things.
Yeah.
We don't have a kind of a place that somebody can really tweak those things and sell it to world. It could be the biggest opportunity and industry. Here lying sleeping under bed in Calcutta.
So that's the sad part, right? When we say Bengal has no industrialization, is that what do we really perceive?
Exactly. You know, the thing is that Kamalika, the fifth chapter of your study, is which points to policy level initiatives at a micro level, so that, you know, one guy, Mr. Dodoria, can do this, or you know, in the CHA project, certain people could do this. A little more cultural construct, but I think that I'm more interested at a personal level to kind of spur new economic opportunities, because that will have a far-reaching effect on the little sort of professional, engage more people, people, and sort of, we have to discover, or rather reinvent, reinvent to package a Murshidabad, Bankura, Sundarban kind of a story, because, you know, you have to sell that story, which is, when we start with this research, identifies opportunities and sort of has certain policy finance sort of
an example is set.
And then
example is set.
Yeah, and then of course the designers comes in, and, you know, I mean, probably one thing that this presentation has excited me a lot is to sort of that this, the practice is not only what we do in terms of design concept tenders, working drawings, and site implementation. This is one deliverable that that we do in terms of making our revenue, but it's also initiating these kind of thought processes, which is also a package. I mean, I could actually buy, and if I would be sitting in the government authority, I should buy a report like this or a concept like this for a certain money, because it actually enables me to open doors, because they're not thinkers. This is a sort of a thinking report. So you're actually almost making people to say that, okay, if you can't think, at least pay us to think. It's a consultation, advocacy kind of a thing. I mean, that is a kind of a way probably we need to sort of take this notion of reports forward. Because it's so popular in America to kind of go to you as a consultant and say, I have a problem, I want to fix it. That's exactly where, let's say, you're the chambers of commerce and they kind of eat and dine and then come back, cribbing about the state, making otherwise millions. That shift can happen when not only this is handed over as a report, but with your fifth chapter.
And last thing, about the Darjeeling project, I'm a little bit excited because I've spent 8 months of my life in Darjeeling. So I got the basic brief, but then what exactly is the outcome that you are working towards? Like you told us about the thing that the stations were torched. They were burned down during the Gorkha insurgency. So what are you, through your work, trying to do about that?
So the thing with Darjeeling is that I'm not directly involved at all. So there is a UNESCO-led team and group which is making a comprehensive conservation management plan. And actually, before that team got appointed also, like we had initiated this with their help, of course, to do this documentation. And so that it could maybe help them. Because it was shocking to even for us to learn that DHR is a World Heritage Site from 1999. But it doesn't have, even till today, a management plan. So there are no guidelines to check any sort of development, conservation. There are just no guidelines. So lots of ad hoc things happen. Of course, the railway is doing what they can. But obviously, then the political situation in the area itself is so sort of fragile that the DHR is like the first victim of any sort of strike. So, to be frank, there's not a project that I'm doing over there. It was a part of a larger process that we thought we could contribute to.
Just one question there, but not a question to forward propositions. More of an inquiry to your experience. I was just wanting to know, see, the most of these communities that you were speaking of, okay, especially with the authorities, okay, like, was there any, like, understanding of the, like, especially when you speak of the Darjeeling case, that there are some communities, okay, because the political, the powers that may be, authorities that may be, they favor, okay, certain group or certain, that's how projects get a certain initiative. Or was it that nothing of that sort mattered? Whatever you instrumentally thought could be possible could be taken forward. Did you find such a this thing in like undercurrent that it's some?
So undercurrent is there in all the contexts, which is why which slows processes down, which change of dispensation and things.
Like I was just wanting to know in Murshidabad, while you talk of very clearly the Jain communities, I just was wanting to know the Muslim communities contribution and their involvement in their precincts and their, was it like such that?
So actually if you trace back in time, so right now the conflict is not there. The conflict might be, see, when does conflict arise? When there is either a disparity of some kind, yeah, economic or social, right? Right now, the entire landscape of Murshidabad is not where economically one is thriving. So those sort of tensions you don't see, but there is a lot of crime because of
politically also. Like let's say today, you can see in UP there is an attempt to erase certain type of history.
I would say that is not there in Bengal. So
not
far,
at all.
This is not there
not
at all.
Not at all.
And in fact, the ecosystem there is very interdependent because
very
the Muslims
much.
Are the karigars and even the tapis and the all the intangible crafts. It's practice. So I would say what we see in mainstream India and we are seeing now with certain deaths, etc., is not there. But there are other issues, other social problems which have arisen out of the economic degradation. So crime is definitely one of the outcomes of that.
Crime is more about politically motivated rather than other things. It's just because the DNA of a communism has a very grassroots level bonding. So if there is a crime on a community, it first judged by a local committee. But right now there is no existence of local committee. Which have a local committee, state committee, and higher committee in communism, about a communist party. But over the period of political change, there's no local committee. So anybody can anything if you have a connection with a councillor or political leaders. So that's why the crime not become an very difficult to control in that way. Probably one thing has happened nowadays. The bureaucrats and the police has the much more powerful than the political leaders, or an political leaders, even the any political involvement peoples. But only question is how they react with each other. That's the problem. So that's why the crime has.
Because it's good, interesting to the China project also.
Yeah.
Okay, I was just thinking, probably it's only possible in Kolkata, not in Mumbai. Okay. Given the tension surrounding these communities, okay, I'm just thinking whether this context would have been the same in a dragon festival, something like that, would be possible anywhere else in the country or not.
So you think that the city allows that comfort here? Yeah, that's what I think. I'm asking that. That is a political or other things, it's not. But it is happening
maybe
right
there
now.
Maybe there is the DNA. I mean, there was in the DNA.
No,
the
probably
CKD
it was a DNA,
hmm.
But it has been never celebrated that way.
Okay.
And people are enjoying very much.
And these are architects and designers. No, it's purely
one is the Dragon Festival. Probably he populated this area, and also government has initiated. Some kind of support.
That's what you require, because you know the thing is that today this whole question of identity, and when you want to reinforce identity, your own identity, either it requires some support or it requires anything, it requires political support, money support, some support. Otherwise, somehow they don't.
But I feel that somewhere I have actually felt in my 12 years of in Calcutta. Slowly, that the city is much more inclusive, expression of identities of communities are stronger. I mean, of course, there are many good things in Ahmedabad and Bombay and all of that stuff, but I think these are the unique qualities that we don't advertise necessarily and make banners out of, but the possibilities of these germinating, you know, you see the whole Gala, Durga Puja festival and all the festivities, that phenomena of communities celebrating is a much more powerful thing that prevails in this part of the country, in this city, compared to a major economic development plan which is top down. So if I take those two nuances together, I think when you take a case of, let's say, I would go back to other sub-centers, with the subconscious desire to make it a polycentric approach. Not a very Kolkata-centric approach. You have a Murshidabad, you have Bakura, you have Sundarbani, you have Darjeeling. So you kind of then create a much more larger matrix of, starting points of ideas. Because, the designer in me then wants to then take a policy level advice and then do something which crafts out and spins off something.
That has a danger, what I always see this tourism approach having its own danger, which I like always the idea of the identity, which is like where the community is more involved, because obviously identity is something I believe every community needs, has to have a certain like right to identity. So, and conservation, I believe, if you take that approach, becomes more sustainable. Tourism has its own, it's good, but it can go the other way also. It has its own
double-edged sword.
The
problem with a place like Murshidabad is that community that is living in Murshidabad, or rather, whatever little I understand, is that they're not there much of it. A lot of things are move to the other, you know.
That is the Jain community. But I'm sure that the Muslim community in Murshidabad are very much there, and they might be marginalized, though they are majority in numbers might be. I'm just guessing, I don't know Murshidabad as a terrain out. It would be an interesting thing to understand.
So I think one basically is there are no formulaic approaches, right? So based on the context, based on what is that ecosystem in that place, somewhere maybe a slightly more like a greater weightage towards a tourism oriented approach might benefit the place, whereas somewhere in Kolkata, Chinatown, where the community lives there. So it's very different when the community continues to inhabit the settlement versus the community that has left that settlement and now it's a ghost town. So those approaches are therefore different and have to be treated differently. Somewhere it's about reinstating identity, somewhere it might be about getting a whole new group of people to come in now inhabit.
And also Murshidabad also includes mosques and other things.
Yeah,
apart
so
from
it really
all those things.
Yeah. So one has to see, I'm looking very zoomed in into Jain Patti. The moment you zoom out,
yeah,
everything that's around gives you a potent
almost like, I mean, just there's a wide discussion, but what happens is when you start putting all of this and putting some numbers to the discussion, and then you can then force one person to move in. That has to be often the government, it could be private, I don't know, those are the like policy level recommendations or something, and then the matter of platforms to take it to the right people. I mean, it seems so one right person here in the state, but still, at least if it reaches that person.
Not only that, imagine how many people like Jadavpur when you've never gone to Murshidabad for a measure.
So that's what I'm imagining.
That is
my greatest problem. That all of this documentation that I've done is all which. Why do I have to offer this course in SEPT? Why can I not take local talent, local college to come and understand and interpret and be proud of what your own state has?
Absolutely. Well, that is very, very ashamed to say. I don't know this information you have. Before IIM, Louis has visited and stayed 5 days in Murshidabad. So Madhav Joshi told me, working with, he's one of the associates. Louis Khan stayed in Murshidabad to understand the big details.
Okay, what about Buckminster Fuller going to Sheikhpur and setting up the first modern movement exhibition? I mean, Bucky Fuller, I mean, Besu is the second school of architecture. We learned that once more from State of Architecture. But I think, so modern movement of architecture actually have Buckminster Fuller visiting Besu, setting up the dome, having the thing, you know, so there was a
list. So one of the Bauhaus movement.
So somewhere, if I can, you know, probably what we're trying to sort of almost.
What I'm trying to say is, it's the whole ecosystem, right? It's education institutions don't want to do. If the young, impressionable minds don't become a part of the process, who's going to come and do this? The state of the state is because of that.
Absolutely, you just say that, sorry, we were off for a few years, but we're back.
We're back, like a bag. Then we have
brought people into Kashmir.
No, it's on lay down.
As students and like just passing this activism in this kind of a thing, but they don't know where to start. They might have found something interesting topic, they research during the thesis, that's it.
Yeah.
And that's like end to it.
Yeah.
Then they get into some firm and then again the same thing
that
they get into.
You have to get off that beaten track of.
So like where do you start? Like if you have some idea, you individually start researching, or like 2-3 like friends, you start researching on something, you come out with some report, like where do you take it or what do you do with it so that it gets somewhere?
Kolkata Architecture Forum. So basically there needs to be, I mean, and that is what we've also, I think, been missing. Just a platform of people who support each other and are willing to back each other up and create an environment where these things can happen, where you don't feel like you're this lone ranger on a mission doing something and then you have to abort it midway and adopt a more mainstream line for your livelihood and career goals, because there's just nobody else, right? So if we are able to create that sort of an environment, then there will be 1,000 studies like this.
Yeah.
And then we'll get a dearth of, you know, like, why, like, I was that, honestly, like, I'm, and I've been very frank, I'm just like, how many measure drawings of the same Haveli in the Wall City do I make? Yes, as an academic exercise, there is value to it because I'm understanding how to draw, how to read, how to interpret. But there is an entire wealth that we don't know about, which is going to shambles. Which is why one of my efforts is just to go to places where nobody goes. And that is just creating new material. So it has to also, I think, be self-drive.
Yeah, also, I'm Mariam, if you just initiate anything, you find that many people will be supporting you. It's not a problem. Just
yeah. Like, even with the authorities, it's a problem. Like, we don't have a proper system, like, in government or in any authority. Like, you take it to them, they would look forward, like, where to implement it or what else.
No, that's,
like,
that's
like a design idea that you are taking forward.
No, that's a problem and you have to overcome. There will be many ways to overcome that. So it may not be not individual, probably a collective effort will be make more sense to the people. So it will happen. It takes time because you have to working in India is a different skill you require. So,
but I think as architects, the responsibility really lies in each one of you to look beyond just doing projects. And if you do that, then you will really be a responsible professional.
Right, absolutely.
Doing something for the profession and giving back and just not wanting the profession, looking at the profession as a means of livelihood. Or like having a signature building built somewhere, which is great.
I think it's also a question of a paradigm shift in architecture and also architectural practice and education, where like obviously the normal paradigm would be you wait for a client. Okay, client comes to you and gets you a project. But I think now you have to overturn that. You have to create projects. Your client might be not paying you money. You have to find money for how to get money for that client. And you have to take forward with your clients to the government to say that we need to implement this project. So it's called, and there's not that it's framed by me or anything. It's already been written about quite a lot. It's called unsolicited architecture, and well, now everybody understands that that's the way to go forward, because if we need to address the crisis, if architects need to address the crisis or want to play a little bit of a role to address the crisis which humanity is facing, I think that's the way forward, because otherwise, don't wait for your clients. The clients, if you wait for your clients to give you the next project, those projects might be the projects you might not want to do also.
Yes.
Okay. So you need that, and you have to recognize that paradigm shift. It's already your generation is facing the paradigm shift. Maybe our generation did not face the paradigm shift. We were trained into architecture to believe that clients would come to us, and that's how we opened offices. But at this point, you build projects. You build projects along with communities. You build projects along with your friends. Okay. And if you have support, if you have a constituency, they will see to it that your project gets implemented. Authorities listen only to constituencies. Authorities only listen to numbers. That's how you take it forward.